Fusion's been around for some time. Fusion energy is the way that the sun delivers its energy.
Fusion reactions don't release any greenhouse emissions. And unlike current fission reactors, fusion eliminates the risk of nuclear meltdowns.
The basic fusion reaction is involving confining at very high temperatures a hot gas of charged particles, and that's what a plasma is, okay? If you take a solid and you heat it, it becomes a liquid. If you heat a liquid, it becomes a gas. If you keep heating the gas, it becomes a collection of charged particles, you know, ions and electrons and such. Over 99% of the visible universe is made up of plasmas. And the particular application that we're interested in is how do you work with a hot plasma gas and confine it in a real world situation so that it can produce fusion energy. But what are the scientific obstacles to make this happen? And one of them is that, you know, you're not going to confine a hot plasma very long, indefinitely. And so one of the fastest ways that the plasma can escape is through these large-scale disruptive events. That just means you have a sudden release of a lot of plasma, and it could leave collateral damage, you know, not like a bomb can do, but, you know, it can damage the confining vessels and stop the experiment and so forth, all of which are quite expensive. And, you know, you can't have a fusion prototype reactor if it's disrupting.
Scientists needed a way to predict these disruptions before they happened.
And the basic workflow works in this way. You know, you have a lot of data, and then you have a final yes-no binary decision. In this case, for the problem at hand, the prediction is, will it disrupt, will it not disrupt? The first principles-based approaches couldn't even hit close to 80% predictive capability. They were maybe in the 70% or less, and sometimes not better than a coin flip. So along came these machine learning-based methods, statistical methods, culminating in these shallow learning approaches using support vector machines, which could get up to 85% and better with less than 5% false positive.
To improve prediction rates, Professor Tang and his team at Princeton trained a neural network capable of taking into account far more variables than the earlier support vector machines.
With the hyperparameter tuning through the ability to deal with many, many more hidden variables and such, we were able to make predictions that relax this criterion that what do you do if you can go beyond 30 milliseconds before a disruption? You know, you can go to 50, maybe even 100. Then that's a big practical impact to the people at ITER and everybody else that's trying to figure out what methods you can use to then avoid disruptions, because you've got a larger operating window now.
While these figures are an estimate of general effectiveness, Professor Tang cautions that results are dependent on the dataset used, and for an apples-to-apples comparison, we would need a systematic comparison study.
Whether we apply this to fusion or not, it'll be applied to many other areas like cancer research, and to we have a pending collaboration with colleagues at Argonne National Laboratory, you know, that are doing cancer remediation research. And coming back to hyperparameter tuning, if you look at the complicated workflows that are associated with the hyperparameter tuning, there are significant similarities between what we do in this clean energy fusion domain and the cancer domain, and you can't find two more different sorts of application targets, cancer and clean energy fusion. But yet the cross-disciplinary cross-cuts there are fascinating.